senior data scientist at Alice. Currently, I'm working at one of the Sweden's biggest retailers, building their product, a personalized offer management system. So first, I want to take you through a small introduction slash motivation to like why we are here. This is a study by McKinsey, which shows the potential value that you can unlock with advanced analytics and AI, grouped by different areas. And in the top right, you see the typical effort, where you try to effectivize operations, automating supply chain management, etc. But one overlooked area is, of course, marketing and sales, where we can see a tremendous value that you can potentially unlock. So it's not that mysterious that a marketing company and a AI company partner up. And in the bottom, you can see risk, product development, and finance, etc. But the two biggest ones are supply chain management and marketing and sales. So the agenda today is to talk a bit about offer management, what actually makes a great offer. Then recommendation engines, how can we use them as a way to give data back to the customers? And also something which is called next best action modeling. So if you were given a one-to-one time with your customer, what would you actually say to the customer? And all of this needs something we call building blocks for big brain analytics, which I will go through at the end, okay? So what makes a great offer? Is it something that the customer would have bought anyway? Is it something new, interesting, which the customer haven't tried yet? Or is it simply something that will maximize your profits? Well, to get from this mass scale targeting to personalized offer communication, you need to ask yourself the question, does the offer make sense? So there will be a constant trade-off between the customer interests. Is it relevant for the customer? Do the customer actually want to buy this? And the business objectives, the profitability. Do we actually profit in some way from this offer? So first of all, I would like to start by asking who should get what offer. And if you divide it, and you can start aiming at different aspects, there might be a customer which has very high share of wallet, great potential, it's a super good customer. Then you might want to aim your offers at loyalizing this customer. Whilst there is someone with a really high potential, but a low share of wallet, then your offers should be aimed at increasing the share of wallet. So you should target your offer for that customer at something they don't buy at your company, but someone else's. Or if you see that the customer has been active buying a certain product, but they have stopped, perhaps you need to reactivate the customer, target the customer with an offer so they start buying that article again. Or if none of the above, you can just aim for sustainable profitability. Like if the customer has a pretty high share wallet, is quite loyal already, doesn't need any reactivation, then what's the best thing to do? Then probably go for profitability. So the question is, if the customer would buy an article anyway, is there any point in giving the offer? Well, that depends. If your target is to loyalize the customer, then it might make perfect sense to give an offer on an item that you know that they will buy, because it will create loyalty for the customer. However, if the customer isn't a high potential customer, then you might just be giving away the offer for free, basically. So in this graph here, you can see a number of offers. And then the red is the probability that the customer will buy this article without you doing anything. While the green one is if you give an offer to the customer, what's the probability that they will redeem this offer? And the difference between those two is called an uplift. And in most cases, you probably want to maximize the uplift so that you give out an offer on something they wouldn't have bought anyway. But given an offer, they will buy this article. But then the question is, are you calculating this today, mathematically? Do you have prediction models that will help you gain insight in what customer should receive what offer and why? When it comes to recommendation engines, Emma talked a bit about recommendation engines. That's a great opportunity to give data back to the customer. And also, it depends on what you're optimizing for. Are you optimizing for short-term sales? Then we have the frontiers, which is Amazon and Zalando, where they utilize the recommendation engine to sell something to you. So you have clicked at a lot of different articles on Amazon, you have bought a certain amount, then what's the best recommendation in terms of short-term sale? That's what probably what Amazon will recommend you. But instead, if your goal is long-term customer growth, we see experts like Spotify and YouTube, where their aim is not to sell you anything in the short term, but rather they want to build a great product which recommends something that you actually want. And in that sense, they build your loyalty and they build customer growth over time. And I want to make a stand for keeping it interesting as well. I believe that even though Netflix popularized recommendation engines, the recommendation engines is quite boring. I very rarely see something recommended to me that I actually want. I sit there scrolling at least for 2 hours before choosing a movie. But in YouTube, it's the opposite. I can't get away from YouTube because they always recommend new movies that is relevant to me in some way, but it's also kind of random in an explorative way, which is, I find, very fascinating. So this is, I say, our way as data scientists, the way to give the data back to the customers so that they feel that their data is being used for them. So that Emma mentioned the glue that you should not mess up the customer's algorithm. And this is how we make sure that their data, or rather that they feel that their data is being used for their own good. Next best action modeling is if you are given a one-to-one communication with your customer, what do you actually say? So this is when you move away from these large scale targeting where a big group of people get the same content and the same offer, etc. But rather now, each and every customer gets its own communication, its own offer, its own actions. So this is just a brief overview of the landscape we're dealing in. I want to demonstrate the complexity of the landscape, where you might have different strategic concepts, and perhaps the customers are in different points in the customer journey. The context of the customer, where are they right now? Then what tone of voice should you use for this particular customer? The actual content. The content. And in what channel? Email? Is it in SMS or online? Or where should you communicate to the customer? And of course, then you might have I picked the number just 1,000 offers, but of course you can have 100,000 or 1,000,000 different potential offers which you can give the customer. And this will create over 5,000,000 unique combinations of how you can communicate with your customer. So how to solve this problem? It's the next best action model, which is the big brain of your organization. So I want to take you through this model from right to the left in this case. So given a customer, what is the best action? Is it to sell something to the customer? Or should you serve the customer in some way? Or if the customer is about to leave you, your best choice might be to retain the customer. There's actually one point missing here, and that is do nothing, but let's not dig too deep into that. So at the core, you have your big brain deciding, should you sell, serve, or retain? And to decide that, you need to take into account two different aspects. It's first of all, the customer needs. What do the customer actually want? And how does the customer look, etc.? What segment does the customer belong to? Has the customer recently bought something? Has the customer moved, etc.? And then, of course, it's your business objectives. What do you want to achieve? You might want to maximize the profits, or in short term, or in the long term, by increasing the customer lifetime value in some way. And all of these actions that you can take need to be weighted among each other to see what is actually best for this particular customer and your business needs. And of course, you will need all the data that you can get your hands on in order to take these decisions. And then it's of course the part where you need to build the big brain using machine learning and AI. And in order to do that, I want to give you an overview of some building blocks that you will need to have in place in able to do to build this big brain next best action model. And I want to perhaps stir up some emotions by saying that this is probably the most typical data science capability. I have a lot of friends in data science, and I've been at a few customers where I see this way too often, that the data scientist in their corner playing around with the data, building models, building proof of concepts, but nothing gets to production. So in the end, no value has been provided for the company. But it's great fun though, really. I've been there myself. It is great fun. So being able to not end up in the playground, you would need to make sure that you have your building blocks in place. And when it comes to data, which will be the most valuable asset in the 21st century, you will need to take really good care of your data. And that means that all data you have, click data, third-party data, other customer data, needs to be linkable to a customer. I've been in places where you have 5 different teams sitting on data, and they all have a different system for identifying the customer. And then you want to bring the data into one place, and they say, oh no, we can't do that because we have no link between that set of customer keys and the other set of customer keys. So it's really, really crucial that you can access the data within one analytical environment, of course, and that all data is linkable back to the customer. Otherwise, it cannot be used for modeling. And then on top of your data, you must have your analytical environment. And of course, it needs to have the right analytical tools. And that depends on your competence and what needs you have. But regardless of that, I believe that your analytical environment needs to be collaborative. You need to be able to share your work between data scientists and between data engineers and all the people which are working within this environment. And it also needs to be scalable, meaning that the worst productivity killer is probably having to wait for a job to run for 2 weeks or whatever. So if your environment is not scalable, that's where you will end up in 1 or 2 years, because 90% of all the data was created the last few years, and the data grows exponentially. So if you cannot scale, then you will end up in that situation, basically. And now we get back to, and this is basically the playground, the sandbox I showed you in the previous slide. So how do you actually get from this sandbox to having your models in production? And that's where this ML framework, machine learning framework, comes into play. It could be just like a way of working, but that rarely gets the job done, I would say. What the ML framework should do is, given the data you have created, your data sets, which your data scientists have spent time creating, you should take the data sets, build the models, and then ship them to production automatically. No one should be able to do this work, or no one should have to do this work by hand. That should be done automatically. And of course, it needs to be very intuitive so that anyone can use it. It also needs to be flexible, meaning that even though you can just push the button saying play, and it will take you, it will train your model on your data, deploy it to production, it should also be flexible enough so that you can choose what are you optimizing towards, what features are you actually going to use, etc. And that's actually where Peltarion comes in, bridging the gap between the sandbox and the production environment. And then you need to have your foundational models in place, in production, ready for everyone to use. And here is a list of a few of the models, which I think are the most essential. It's churn prediction, predicting whether your customer is likely to churn in the near future or not. That will feed as an input then to the customer lifetime value. So depending on what your predicted revenue income of this customer is, what is your predicted cost of this customer in terms of support, etc., and also what is the potential loss in losing this customer, that's all modeled in the customer lifetime value model. And when you have that model, you most likely want to create an attribution model saying that, okay, we have this customer which we have recently brought into the company, it's worth this much, but who actually gets credit for bringing in this new customer? That's very important when you are about to allocate your spend, your media spend or other marketing spend. And also the recommendation engine, which has been a big focus today. I say it's one of the core building blocks. But in the foundation of all of this is the customer trust. If the customer doesn't trust you to use their data for their own good, they will not give it to you. So you cannot build any model in that case. So to summarize this talk, I have also created a checklist. And I really want to stress that all customer data needs to be linked back to the customer, that you can access the data in one environment. Of course, your analytical environment is scalable. You have your automatic machine learning framework deployed and in place to bring you from playground to production. Because otherwise, a lot of value is stuck in the playground, because it's too much of an investment to bring this like smaller optimizations into production, because you need to spend a lot of time in actually coding and bringing your models so that it updates perhaps every night or on demand, or as serve it as an API. It's too much software engineering around that to be able to motivate bringing your proof of concepts in production. But your machine learning framework does it for you and does it automatically, so the cost is basically zero. And then you have your fundamental models, and that you start calculating what you're actually doing. What are you actually doing when you give out this offer? What is the profit we expect? And why do we give out this offer to this customer? And then have your customer trust mindset. And I want to leave you with a last thought, what marketing will look like in the 21st century. These circles are all areas in which human are making the decisions today, or rather yesterday, but where the algorithms will orchestrate all these decisions for you. And I like to view these like small dots as inputs to models. And then we have models which talk to each other to create different decisions based on the customer data and all your different models in the background. And this is how complex it will look in 5 years. Thank you. Yes?
Yeah, as a marketing manager for years, yeah, how do you, I mean, it's a really good code opportunity, but I also know that what Anna said, that 50% of marketing manager will lose their jobs, maybe. So here's what should I do as a marketing manager to really get going? I don't have enough
you
of money to retire.
Yeah, well, I understand your concern. My best suggestion is that you take lead on this. If you take lead on the building blocks, then you have the responsibility to bring them into place, and you will probably be irreplaceable with your company.
Okay, well, what distinct actions can I do when I
Do you have an advanced analytics team?
Yeah, a very small one.
A small one? Yeah, well, start looking at there. Perhaps a good data scientist who knows what he's doing. Yeah. We can talk to you afterwards. Any more questions? I would love to share some more detail about the actual mathematics behind it, if someone is interested. So just talk to me in the break or afterwards. Thank you. I'm gonna take 30 seconds.